Welcome, gamers, to this week's episode of Last Call Gaming. We're episode number 144. Today is August 19th. My name is Craig Prowse, and joining me, as always, in the combat of wearing long sleeve shirts in the middle of summer, Major Montemayor.
You can never deny a nice primitive skateboarding brand, and I only bought this shirt just because that like pink pee that's on it. I love what's on the back. We'll get into that later, but I've always loved their logo, and this one just really spoke out to me. And the fact that it's an anime crossover too, I was all about it.
Oh yeah, you gotta love when they do a nice little mix up. So, guys, thank you for joining us on the show today. If you're watching the YouTube version of the show, give it a like, leave a comment, subscribe if you're not already subscribed, share and hit the notification bell. If you guys are interested in following us on any of the social medias, our Linktree link is in the description. And if you guys are listening to the audio-only version of this podcast, check us out wherever podcast platform you prefer. That's a tongue twister. Or you can check us out on Anchor, which is the home for us, which there you can also support the show. Any sense you want to add on that?
I don't know if I could re-say everything that you just did without getting mixed up too, so don't feel bad. I could barely make it through that last sentence.
It's always a tongue twist in the beginning. So before we get into our main stories, guys, we want to talk about what are you up to? Where Andrew and I take a second, we talk about what we've been playing, what we've been watching. So we're gonna each do what we've been playing, and then we're gonna kind of joint talk about what we've been watching, because we're recording a little later today because we both just got out of the same movie and we're both kind of talk about that. So Andrew, how much further into your gaming nonsense are you?
Actually, I put down The Walking Dead. I didn't play it. I was playing Call of Duty all week, but just so I could talk about something different besides Call of Duty, even though it seems like we're always talking about Call of Duty. I started playing Multiverses. I wanted to give it a go again for any of those who live in under a rock. That is the new Super Smash Bros. Clone that has like Warner Brothers. So you have, you know, Wonder Woman, Batman, Velma, Shaggy, Tom and Jerry, pretty much just like a brawler. And so far, I'm undefeated. I'm 6-0. But again, those are only like the 2v2s.
Who's your character?
I've used Batman, Arya Stark, and I used Diana.
Okay,
Wonder Woman, because she was the only free one.
Yeah, so you're not gonna keep playing with it?
I don't think so. I don't like it as much as I do Super Smash Brothers. I just feel like the chemistry is just not there for why these characters are together. If you haven't played this, it does. I mean, it almost kind of controls like Smash Brothers, but I just don't think that feels as tight. It doesn't feel terrible. It does feel good. But I think part of the Smash Brothers charm too, unless you're a purist, you know, there's purists out there, is I like using the weapons, like, you know, throwing the Pokeball and seeing what's going to come out. And sometimes you get the Magikarp, and so it's shit luck, but it doesn't do anything. Sometimes you get the Jigglypuff. You throw the exploding capsule, the little mines. I feel like that chaoticness is what is fun for me in Super Smash Brothers, that I'm just doing the same thing, you know. I'm just sitting here mashing buttons and just hitting people. Another thing I kind of didn't like is maybe there's no sort of, unless there's not that big a difference between it, but I don't know because the guy on my team quit out, is it didn't seem like there's any sort of, at first I'm playing with other people that are level 1, but then I got thrown into a match with people that are level 20, and my partner was level 20, and he's the only guy who didn't ready up, and I was still level 1, and I assume that's the reason why, and the match didn't go forward because he quit out, and I assume he quit out maybe because he didn't want to take the L with me or something, but other than that, the rest of them were kind of 1, so I'm like, I don't know if I care about that. I think the thing that maybe turns this off about me the most, especially if you're wanting people to engage and experience this game, especially if you're trying to compete with something like Smash Brothers, is you only get one free character, and then the free characters that I think they swap them out, almost like when Killer Instinct first launched. Like, I think it's like every week or something like that. And I was like, I don't know if I like that. I get that this game was free, but maybe make your money from like a battle pass, or which there is one in there too, or
the cosmetics,
or other cosmetics besides, you know, give me like at least one alternate skin or something. Because when you get Super Smash Bros., even though you pay for it, I feel like that's what keeps me engaged. Is like, maybe I don't like Batman because Batman is like too advanced for me, and Wonder Woman is too different that I can't really experiment with anyone else besides like Arya because she's different. There's a lot of people that are different, and it just doesn't feel the same, you know what I mean? Like, when you pick up Smash Brothers, there's so many different people you can play with that you could work your way up from easy to beginner to medium, hard, whatever, to where I feel like well, you have Diana, and then you have these other two that are complex to learn, so I kind of just have to stick with her or just deal with, you know, like when I played Batman, I was doing fine, but I also felt like I was missing a lot of attacks, and I'm kind of just not getting it. So, how was your experience? How did you played it?
I was playing it, and I will say this, it's infinitely better than the Nickelodeon Arcade Brawl or whatever, because I was playing that on PS5. Dude, that game sucks. So this one does feel at least a little more weighty. Like, it is no Smash Brothers, and it's hard for anything to kind of mimic that to perfection. But I mean, I agree with a lot of what you're saying. The only thing that I think I like about it that is different from like a Smash Brother is if you do want to keep playing with these characters, I mean, yeah, they're not exactly the same. There's a different learning curve, but like, I like the fact that you can level them up.
Right.
And I like that there's a daily challenge for doing something with certain characters. So I think they're onto something. But with everything you're pointing out that's just kind of the flawed aspect of it, it's like, I don't know if they're there yet. But I mean, for a game that's taken, for as long as Smash Brothers has held the reins, like, this is a pretty decent competitor. So I had fun with it, but I only play Wonder Woman, though. So my Wonder Woman's like a level 10. I've popped some chibis on it. I mean, it's fun, but I'm not a big brawler type player anyway, so I might just play this every, like, so often when I just need something to kind of, like, wash the palate and be like, okay, what can I do for a little bit that I can listen to a podcast and do that?
I think jumping back to the final thing I'll say about it is, like I was saying, almost kind of the tone for why these people are together. Like, at least in Smash Brothers, like, Ganondorf doesn't say anything. Like, they have a way to where you feel like these people fit and it's believable and why they're kind of together. Whereas this, you have, like, Bugs Bunny, it's like, what's up, Doc? Followed by Diana behind him, like, I'll never let the innocent be harmed. And I'm just like, oh my, okay, she's like talking like a lot and always saying like her little slogans, like, I'm Diana of Themyscira and I am the strongest, or I'll kill any villain, whatever it is that she's saying about justice and stuff like that. But then you have fucking Shaggy over here eating a sandwich.
Yeah, well, and they do have a couple items, because I do remember picking up a sandwich and like throwing it and stuff. Yeah,
well, but that's his personal item. That's like, because
I was playing a game and I don't think Shaggy was even in it. Maybe it was, but I don't know. I know there's a couple of throwable items, but yeah, not on the scale of like the Pokeball coming up, the hammer, and all that stuff like that. So, but I mean, Multiverse is doing pretty good so far. So hopefully they can at least keep it up, because it's always nice to have something else in that space.
What are you playing right now?
So I didn't really play too much more than normal. More Fall Guys, but I'm still playing Vanquish, which I'm now on Chapter 3, I think Mission 5. But dude, this game is a game I think you'll actually dig. It's just super fast, super action packed. You guys should check it out. I would definitely wait, though, because this game's always on sale. So right. If you are interested in getting it, I don't know if it's a $20 game or a $29.99 game, mm-hmm. but it's always on sale. So you guys should definitely check it out when you can. It's got cigarettes, robots, and heavy gunplay. So what more can a boy ask for?
Sounds like Metal Gear.
Yeah. So so that's what we've been playing. So let's talk quickly about what we just got done watching. So Andrew and I just got out of the theater earlier today. With my brother, with Saya, with Dante, and we saw Dragon Ball Super Superhero. Now, if you guys aren't familiar with that, quickly, the plot is for this movie is, let me pull it up here, is the Red Ribbon Army was once destroyed by Son Goku. Individuals who carry on its spirit have created the ultimate androids, Gamma 1 and Gamma 2. However, these androids call themselves superheroes and start attacking Piccolo and Gohan. So the premise of the movie, when you watch the trailer, is that this is kind of going to be more Gohan and Piccolo focused, and I originally thought that the Gammas, the androids, looked kind of lame and weren't going to be cool at all. They're actually surprisingly very likable in this movie. I love them. It did just drop today, so today was the day it actually came out. You could have watched the midnight release the day before. It's getting great scores. Rotten Tomatoes sits at a 90%. Fandango has it at a 93%, so it's doing very well. But the first thing I think we...
Something that's always been drawn, you know, they've always had their kind of art style, whether they like update it or not, and take it to this new art form, you can almost kind of lose the heart of what a series is based on something like that. And I thought they totally nailed it.
Yeah, so keeping in that, like, the spirit of this is Dragon Ball Super, Dragon Ball Z. One of the cool things that they did is they showed off a lot of characters, like, new and old, and they did a lot of like throwbacks and like inside jokes. I don't want to spoil anything for you guys, because half the fun is hearing it when you watch it, but I think they did it a lot of justice. The combat was exceptionally cool to watch. Once you actually started seeing this fight, you know, all the action that starts going on there, it's really, really cool to watch. It lives up to, you know, the action-packed, you know, series of Dragon Ball Z and Super that we all know. So on that aspect, I mean, I think it did keep the heart. The action was awesome. The storyline itself is a little slow. There's kind of a lot of like story setup, some exposition that they do. I would definitely say the second half of the movie is by far better than the first half, because it is kind of like a slow burn to get where it needs to be. But once it gets there, it's all good Dragon Ball fun.
Yeah, it does take a little bit for the exposition, but if you're a Dragon Ball fan, you can easily sit through it. It's not like I was bored. It's not
all fighting in action. Not fighting on your leather seat.
Yeah, but the build-up to it was perfect, and I think it had, like, a perfect ending, too. Like, it was finally nice to see some characters get the justice I feel that they deserve versus being, like, snubbed for all these years.
Yeah, especially when it comes to certain people that, you know, just weren't in the spotlight in recent years. Like, this movie did put a shine on the characters, and I think they did a great job with that. So definitely go check it out. It's definitely worth seeing in theaters. I mean,
for sure.
When that sound was going off and certain enemies were fighting and the combat was going, I think it's worth paying the $10 and sitting it and enjoying it in a theater. And it's weird that these movies don't normally come to theaters. I know. Or usually they go to IMAX. Like, the last movie, we would have had to have gone to Vegas to see it. It was cool that our chain finally got it here in our town, which means it's getting more and more popular, and it's reaching more of these outlets.
Right, because I remember before, we weren't even sure that it was going to come to theaters here. And then I happened to go see Top Gun after you did, and I snapped you the photo as soon as it was on the wall. I was like, well, I know what we're doing on this date.
Yeah.
And so I was like, okay, dope. That is cool. And it is a sign that, even though it's been hugely popular, again, this is a skateboarding brand, and on the back of it is, Goku Black, and it's a Dragon Ball Z crossover shirt, and again, that's something super mainstream, taking two things that are considered mainstream now in a blend like that. You see it everywhere.
Yeah, I will say this, though. My only thing I would point out as a fan is I actually just watched the Dragon Ball Super Broly movie that Saya, shout out to Saya, who bought me. After watching it, because I pretty much watched them back to back, I still would think the Broly movie is the better movie that I liked so far. So, and that's after watching them back to back. And I'm not saying one blows the other one out of the water, but if I had to pick one, I think the Broly movie is still my better pick for those. Or do you like the other one more?
I think I'd take the other one more, but it might only be because of all the fan service moments that are in this. Yeah. There's so many that are so good, and I didn't feel like, oh man, you're shoving it down my throat. I'm like, damn, this is what I want to see. Like, that was so cool.
Yeah, so leave down your guys' thoughts below if you've seen it, what you thought about it. Leave us your thoughts on Super in general and the Broly movie. So that is what we've been playing. That is what we just watched. So guys, with that down and out of the way, let's move into our main story. And so we are going to be sticking with some movies and TV. Our main topic is going to be about Tekken Bloodline, which just dropped on August 18th, so yesterday, with 6 eps, roughly around 20 minutes apiece on Netflix. Now, I got to say, it's definitely better than I thought it was going to be. And overall, when I'm looking at the different outlets and how they've been reviewing it, it seems to be doing steady. Like, it's like a B. You know what I mean? It's not falling behind. It's not pulling ahead. It's right in that meaty part of the curve. I liked it a lot, and in a second we'll get into cons and pros for it, but overall, before we dive into that, what was your thoughts initially going into this when you saw the trailer versus the outcome that you got?
I was kind of hyped for it because I haven't kept up with Tekken in like a while. I know the basic story, and watching this, like, I felt like it was fulfilled, I guess. We can get the pros and cons later, but I was looking at the reviews too, and people, there are some outlets that are saying it's a little higher, but saying that it does do justice to the franchise overall, and I can agree with that. I'm like, yeah, you know what, I think the worst part would maybe be you're always wanting more, but I felt like it definitely was fulfilling to watch.
Yeah, so let's start with the pros then, because that's actually what I have on my list, is that it stayed true to the source material, which is definitely I don't want to say it's hard to do, but a lot of times when people take a reimagining of a video game property, that's what gets lost in translation. They try to make their own story out of something that we already know and love, and they did a really good job sticking to what Tekken is, and from what I can tell, I think this is supposed to be based on Tekken 3 as far as the video games go. So they did a great job with the source material. What I also liked is that it jumped straight into the story. There was no filler episodes. I mean, when you've got 6 episodes, you've got to try to pack as much story into it as you can.
Right.
So even though I think, and that is part of my con, and I'll get into that when we do there, but like, I think what they did with their time was great. The other part that I loved was it also has a different animation style. We were talking about that earlier, and we can dive into that, is that I like that these guys are experimenting with new styles. Obviously, we're seeing that in Dragon Ball Super movie, but Even recently, when you look at things like Arcane, that's a different kind of art style than we're used to. Dragon Prince, Dragon Ball Super. So I like that this one took a different approach, doing a different type of look that stands out from everyone else. At first, I didn't like it. Like, on episode, like, one and two, I was just kind of like, I'm like, I don't love this. But then as it gets more into the combat-filled episodes, I was like, this is awesome.
That's exactly what I was saying. Like, at first, maybe for, like, normal when they're walking and stuff, it didn't feel as right at first, but it wasn't until you got to the combat, they're like, okay, I understand it now, because now this feels heavy-handed. It feels like the punches are there. Like, the combat feels like you're watching someone play the game, and these moves are, like, very fulfilling, especially with the way that they do it and how they're stylized. I absolutely love the way the combat looks in this show. I was like, damn, I don't know if I've seen combat done in a show like this that I love more in recent years. You know, obviously Dragon Ball Z looks good. You've got Naruto that looks good. I think out of a more recent made things, I actually loved the way that looked.
Yeah. Was there anything, so those were the main kind of pros I had. Was there anything else that kind of sticks out to you that would be like a shine, or do you think that's kind of the highlights?
I think the biggest highlight, and again, just going over it, is the combat and watching everybody's different styles. Like, just, it never felt like it was, like, sticking, you know? Sometimes when you're watching, like, animation, you feel like maybe there's a lull in a fight or something. I felt like everything just really, like, flowed on this, and I absolutely loved it.
Nice. Okay, so the pros, I think, are worth watching the show, especially, it's about 2 hours. I mean, you can knock the show out in one sitting in 2 hours, so time-wise, it's definitely doable. As far as the cons go...
I wrote my stuff out of order. The other thing I did want to add that I did like was the music choice. Like,
thank you, because the music was awesome.
I wrote my stuff out of order here. The music was really good, and Tekken's one of those games that, like, I couldn't tell you, oh, well, this is this guy's track, or this is whatever. But when I'm watching, I'm like, oh, man, that sounds totally, from what I remember Tekken being, it sounds exactly perfect.
Nice. Okay, good, yeah. Because, you know, I'm going to put it there just so it's on my notes forever. Yeah, the music was awesome. As far as the cons go, the first one that stood out to me like a sore thumb is I was not a fan of the English voice acting. I couldn't stomach it. I did number one. I started number two, and I'm like, I can't do this. So I actually turned mine to Japanese, and then I just watched it in subtitles. So did you finish it in English, or how did you feel about it?
I like the English voice acting. I didn't even think to put it to subtitles. Maybe this is a show, because it's more, like, in Japan and stuff, that I probably should have. But I was just already cruising through it. So I'm like, all right, whatever. It was fine for me.
Well, Hayachi just sounded completely off to me.
That was in my notes, is Hayachi's voice is the only one that seems like he's speaking, like, it's not his voice is bad, but it's just way off, and it's almost like maybe it's just trying to match the mouth movements or whatever it is they're doing versus having him turned around while he's talking. But I forgot at one point that really stuck out. He's like, tonight you'll be coming with me to a business dinner. Yeah. And it's like, instead of saying that one set, like, it was literally that long of a break to it. And again, this isn't like a make or break for the show. Like, I watched it all through English, but Hayachi specifically is the only one that is like that all the way through for some reason. That's the one thing I wrote down. Hayachi dialogue a little off.
So yeah, that was my main thing. It was an easy fix. So if you are an anime, you know, just said it to Japanese. The Japanese was awesome. So I was just like, okay, cool. I'll just read the subtitle.
At least
so.
The voice acting wasn't bad as far as like, like voices like that,
like Gohan's kid in the Super movie. I hated the way she sounded. The next thing I would say that was a con is, and again, it's not a deal breaker, but like the delayed reactions. Like they would say something, she'd be like, "Oh, like your father." You go, "Huh?" Oh, I'm just like what is this? Like, so it's just, it just kind of throws me out of the scene sometimes when they were doing that. But again, nothing that's like that bad. I thought the biggest thing that they did is they missed out on some characters. Like, when they go to the fighting, the tournament, they show a lot of people. And there's people I've been waiting to see, like Yoshimitsu, Craig Marduk, Paul Phoenix. What's Steven's name?
Bear.
Steven Fox, the bear. Like, they showed them, but, like, they didn't do that. And I think there could have been, you could have made this 7 episodes, you know, squeeze one more in there, and let's see a couple more of these fights. I want to see Yoshimitsu's sword. I don't know. I thought the fights were... They missed an opportunity there.
The fights that are there are amazing, but that is something I wrote down. Make it 8 episodes would have been better, so that way you can show off some of those other fights. Because some of these characters, it's a big tournament. You see them lose off-screen, which kind of sucks. I felt like even if you had done like a 2-minute montage of showing the final bouts of all these other matches for the people that lost would have done wonders for that. Again, that was my thing. I'm like, cool, Yoshimitsu, I forget the name of the bear, but he's in there. You have all these other people, and I'm like, I didn't really get to see them. It kind of only focuses on the small cast, and I guess maybe I get it because they really didn't know how the show was going to do, and I felt like that would have... Even just that small montage, if you didn't add another episode or so to kind of pad that out, just a small montage of that would have put this, like, if I was ever giving it, like, a 7 or an 8, that would have definitely been, like, a whole point higher, from a 7 to an 8, an 8 to a 9.
Yeah, and with that being said, with the characters, I thought that they, all the titles, I mean, titles don't really mean anything, but when it comes to, like, anime... They always kind of mean something, and these ones were kind of generic. It was like episode 1, episode 2. I thought they
I
thought it would have been cool if they would have named each one like after a character in the game. Like what episode, who was going to be in this? Like the first one could have been Jin, second one could have been Hayachi, and the third one could have been whoever. And I'm like Harong or something like that. I'm like why would you not just like take the time to at least make your episodes rememberable when I want to talk about
that one? Is the bigger thing too. I'm like, you have this cool tournament called King of the Iron Fist. That couldn't have been the thing. Iron Fist Tournament or King of the Iron Fist would have been a cool fucking name. You have shit like the Devil Gene. Like, why is that? That's a title alone.
Yeah, actually, yeah, that actually would have been a really good one.
So, that that's a small gripe. But yeah, I wish they would have labeled each episode as something just to make it feel like more memorable instead of episode 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, so I mean, as far as the show goes, I think its cons are greatly outweighed by the pros. There's more things I liked about this than the nitpicky things I didn't. And originally, I didn't think I was going to like the show. I actually ended up really enjoying it. I do think it needs to be longer than 6, but they told their story. You know what I mean? And they got to the point. It ends in a certain way. They could do a season 2. But, I mean, if they just leave it at that, I mean, it was a fine season 1.
I would like to see them continue the story. If they left it at that, is that I'm fulfilled. I think what I would like even more, though, especially if maybe you're just waiting and you don't know where you want to take the story, because again, I haven't played Tekken in forever, so I don't know what happens after this, is now you've opened the door for a prequel.
Oh, I actually would like
that. So season 2, do it Spartacus style. That's the first King of the Iron Fist tournament, and go into, you know, the first time they're seeing the Devil Gene and Paul Phoenix is fighting him. Anything from either of the first two tournaments. The first two tournaments make it 10 episodes or something. I don't know. Something.
Yeah, they got options. So with that done out of the way, guys, let us know if you saw it. Let us know if you like it. I think it is worth checking out if you got 2 hours of your time and you're a Tekken fan. So let's move into our second main story, and that is that Call of Duty has been accused of plagiarizing skin from ex-Infinity Ward director At Least Name It After Me, is the article that comes from IGN, and that is going to be in the description if you guys do want to check this out. And it seems to be the second time in many weeks that they've actually done this. So let me read you real quick and just kind of catch you up of what happened. So Activision has been accused of plagiarism for the second time this month after adding a skin to Call of Duty Vanguard and Warzone that looks similar to a character from an ex-Infinity Ward director's new game. As reported by Metro, Call of Duty's new Doomsayer skin has been linked to a character design from Dead Drop, the upcoming game from Dr. Disrespect, otherwise known as Guy Beam, studio Midnight Society. Robert Bowling, a co-founder alongside Beam and the former director of Call of Duty developer Infinity Ward, uses the character as his Twitter profile and posted about the new skin, and he says, "At least name it after me." So I have it pulled up. So right now you guys should be seeing, a side-by-side comparison of the two skins. And I guess they do look awfully similar. I mean, they both have the hood. They both have the dark outfit. They both kind of have this, like, lighter mask. And we'll get into this real quick in a second. But I want to go on to say, because it says that this isn't the first time they've done this. So
right.
It goes on to say, Activision hasn't released a statement regarding the plagiarism accusations as of yet. But its response to similar complaints earlier in August saw the company remove its new skin from the game completely. Samoid skin?
It's like Samoid, I think.
Samoid skin, and operated with a dog's head, was the cause of controversy. Concept artist Sale Lin claimed that Call of Duty lifted their 2-year-old design, prompting Activision to apologize and remove the skin and all references to it from Vanguard and Warzone. So, as far as the skins go, Andrew, you know about this more than I do. Is it common for things to get kind of ripped off like this, or at least kind of have a clone? Because I know we're living in this world where, like, the skin game is king. I see it all day on Fallout with, you know, the new things of the Undertaker and the Halo and Master Chief. We're now seeing Dragon Ball Z in Fortnite, you know, along with God of War and things like that. But those are like licensed IPs that they're taking. Is it common that kind of like made up, I don't want to say generic skins, but original skins get stolen all the time like this? Or is this just a thing that like Call of Duty got caught for?
I don't know. I think they had done it before, too. I was going to say, as far as I know, and they say different in the article, they didn't even release an apology for the Samoyed skin. And that one, for sure, that dude released that art 2 years ago. It's like a human body, but it's, you know, those kind of those dogs, if you know them.
Yeah.
It's that dog head. So it's obviously, they didn't come out with that. That dude had that out way beforehand. But if you look at the other picture that you were talking about, that one that you're showing me on screen.
So the Call of Duty one.
Yeah, the Call of Duty one, the Doomsayer. They have another image of it. That's not the original one I think that they showed. There's a different one of those two standing side by side. And it looks a whole lot more similar. But as far as that apology goes, they didn't even say like an apology. They took the skin down and they're like, on our end, it's like a misstep and we're going to try to be better. They didn't go out of their way to say, hey, you know what? We're sorry. We don't know what happened. Someone accidentally took your skin, or maybe we hired a freelancer or something like that. Because I was just looking at it earlier. As far as I know, they didn't give any sort of personal apology to him, to either of these people. But both of these skins look like they're just like straight ripped.
Yeah, and who's... Yeah, exactly. Like you're saying, we don't know who did this. Like, we don't know who to hold responsible outside of just the company. Because obviously you did it 2 months ago. So it's like, this isn't like something that happened...
No, they're both within the same month. The other one came out in July.
Oh, was it? Yeah, so it wasn't until this happened five years ago and they got busted again. It's like, you're Call of Duty. Every eyeball in the world, even if you're not a video game fan, knows Call of Duty and watches this stuff. So if you're gonna highlight and showcase your new skin, someone's gonna look at that and go, oh, this looks awfully pretty fucking familiar to compare to what we did. Now, I don't know how much the likeness has to be for them to say it's like, you know, like, is it 90% recognizable or comparable that's what they're stealing from?
I was going to say, you should look this up and look at the other original comparison, because looking at that, I mean, it still is similar, but it's not quite the same as what it was. Just so that way, maybe from your opinion, as someone who doesn't play Call of Duty as much, if you can tell me the difference between those two.
What was the skin called?
Doomsayer skin.
Doomsayer. Let's see if they still have a picture up. So, I'll look this up, but like, what do you think happens to them? Did they not get sued?
I don't know how that works. And I mean, that's something that they sell. So obviously those profits have to go somewhere. So I think they should go to the...
Is this what you're talking about?
That was the original one. And tell me how much closer that looks.
Because I don't have this one pulled. So I'll take a copy of this one. And hopefully right now you guys can see this version.
So the left one is the Doomsayer. The one on the right is the guy's art.
Yeah, that is...
In that light, because especially look at like how that chest plate almost lights up the same as that. It's almost like, oh, that chest plate looks a little blue. Let's take a little black up top and that'll look different. Because now he's got a crest on his chest, but just the lighting creates that image almost.
Yeah, the fact that you would make the face the same like light bluish kind of
with
color,
the
like
skull
like,
kind of looking
you
in it.
You could have changed this completely and did different like highlights and things like that to cut. I mean, that is almost like a one for one. So
now,
somebody fucked up.
In their defense, they did release another skin like this in Black Ops 4, not exactly like this, but maybe kind of like a futuristic soldier that has like a red face and whatever. But comparing that, I mean, it's even almost the same like light color blue that they're even using for it to create that image, that it's hands down that I had to take that off. At one point, does it get past the people who approve this sort of thing?
You have
all these people that are supposed to be able to stop you from being sued, that nobody noticed, like, hey, you know, this maybe looks similar to something else, but someone's head's got to roll, or
the other person should be compensated.
Where do you point the blame at, too? Do you say, hey, you know, we're going to compensate you, sorry as of us, but we're going to get rid of this guy, and is it his fault now that you put his name out there so he doesn't end up at another company that is and doing the same thing? Because as far as I know, I can't really remember anyone else doing something like this. This would be the biggest one, but again, twice within a 2 month span.
That is a slappy, slappy, slappy. So I don't know how much more to say on it. I mean, it happened. It's done. Two in a month is can't look good for you. But I mean, it's not going to make anyone stop playing Call of Duty, so...
I was going to say, I think the only thing that maybe I can remember that's even close to this is they had another skin come out that was a woman, and she has, like, a ponytail, and she's, like, a soldier with, like, some, like, stuff on her face or whatever, that ended up... And I think they used the same actress. Now, there's a guy who had that actress dress up almost looking exactly like that before the game came out, and he took a picture of her, and it's almost like they, even though they paid that actress for her likeness, it's almost like they used that photo as how to dress her and make her look in the game. Mm. And I remember that kind of turned into like a big thing too, as them kind of plagiarizing. That is not the same as this.
Right,
that,
but like took her likeness and
putting it into the game. So maybe thinking if we pay for her likeness, that image kind of doesn't count because it's just in armor style fatigues or whatever. So I don't know how that one like panned out. But again, you know, there's, I think they need to put out a better statement than we need to do better and we messed up. Like, yeah. Something has to be done about that. If it was just the one, then whatever. Or not whatever. Apparently the people let it be whatever, but twice in 1 month.
That's a couple of whatever. So, yeah, it's Call of Duty. You know, what won't they do? So, that's our two main topics, guys. Leave down in the comments below what your thoughts are on them. So, with that down, guys, we're going to move into questions of the week. Now, if you guys want to submit a question that Andrew and I can answer on the show, you guys can leave them down in the YouTube comments down below. You guys can email one at us at lastcallproductions@gmail.com, or you can at me at Craig Paralis on social media, and I can pull it from there. So, question one, guys, comes from Divine Anchor, and they write, "Hey, I guess in relation to this episode, which was last week's episode, how do you guys feel about the report that Microsoft paid $600,000 just for the game Cooking Simulator to be on Game Pass? Also, Gary Whitta over at Kinda Funny said he heard from a source Sony paid to keep Cult of the Lamb off of Game Pass day one." So I guess to address the second part is that was put to bed. That was kind of circling right around, and a lot of people were...
Everyone was reporting on that.
Was looking at it, but Devolver Digital, who makes the game Cult of Lamb, flat out just said that this rumor is absolutely untrue. So I'm going to believe them and take them at their word that that's something that they didn't do. But as far as the Microsoft goes, so yeah, apparently Microsoft paid $600,000 for Cooking Simulator on Xbox Game Pass report. So this comes to us from TrueAchievements.com, and it says, "A new financial document claims that Microsoft paid a whopping $600,000 to developer Big Cheese Studio to get Cooking Simulator onto Xbox Game Pass. Deals between Microsoft and publishers, developers for Xbox Game Pass titles are a bit of an enigma. However, a new financial report, thanks to Twisted Voxel, sheds a little more light on the process, claiming that Microsoft has a $600,000 contract with developer Big Cheese Studio for putting Cooking Simulator onto Xbox Game Pass." Now, if your question is how we feel about it, I'm sure Andrew will have his way, but like, I'm not really sure because I don't know what other games specifically get paid for. So obviously, at face value, you know, even they're kind of pointing out a whopping $600,000. That is high in anybody's eyes. But like, what did a game like Nobody Saves the World make? Because if Nobody Saves the World, which is infinitely a better game and is in my top five for the year, if they only got $300,000, then yeah, $600,000 for Cooking Simulator is obnoxious and absurd. But if they got $800,000, you know, I don't really know where to set the bar. So the only thing I kind of wanted to point out is that, and this is on GameSpot.com, they pointed out that Microsoft, with a library around 3,000 games on ID at Xbox and $2.5 billion in payments to developers, the math works out to being around $830,000 per game. So with that context, Cooking Simulator falls under what the average game should be costing. But again, it's give or take, as some games are going to get paid more and less. But 600 sounds big, but I just don't know what to compare that to know if it's more than what it should have gotten.
Yeah, that was kind of my big thing too. I know they break it down a little bit in like some of those other articles. It goes into like part of like their business annuity and something else, and it's like 2.2% of, you know, however much they're planning to make. There's like a little bit of math to it. But my big thing when I saw that was, well, I've never even heard of this game, and it looks like, again, just one of the, we have Power Washing Simulator, the Grass Cutting Simulator. If this game is getting that much, and this isn't a game, unless I'm out of the loop, that I ever thought set the world on fire, maybe on Steam or something like that, because I think this game came out on Steam like 2 years ago.
Yeah, I think this game came out like in 2019. So it's like, what are you paying this for?
If you're paying that much for this kind of game, how much would something like Cult of the Lamb cost? Or what was, I always forget the name of it, but you really liked it a lot, that Destiny style game that you, me, and Dante.
Outriders.
How much did Outriders cost? Because Outriders looks like a far infinitely better game than, you know, just like a little cooking simulator. So I that was my big question. I've seen this, I feel like that's a lot of money for a game that maybe again to me, if it's anything like the other simulators, yeah, is just like one of those basic average game. I feel like that's crazy overpaying. I might be wrong. I can't see the numbers, so I don't know how many people are going to do that, because I'll admit, I've given the Power Washing Simulator a little try lately.
So, oh, I beat the first... I did the van with the red dog and did the achievement. I was like, oh, okay, I can see it. But yeah, because the cooking game might be awesome fun. I kind of wanted to play it before we recorded, but we just didn't get a chance to. There's probably something there. It just... When we're comparing it with like Outriders or Nobody Saves the World or any number of other titles, it just seems like there's a lot of these other games have more to them than just this cooking simulator. But I mean, these may be they may have looked and saw that all the past simulator games, more people are playing those than Nobody Saves the World. More people are playing those than Outriders. So maybe Big Cheese was warranted at 600K. Because good for the studio. I don't want to take anything away from the studio and the guys that make that game.
You're right.
But when you're comparing it to the 3,000 games, you know, that's collectively with on Xbox, it's like, that's the game that's got almost $1 million for it. So
right, no, that's what I was saying. I was like, man, that's like a high. I mean, that's higher than I ever thought it would have been. But again, who am I to say?
Yeah. So thank you for the question, Divine Anchor. The next question comes from John Tovitz, and he writes, "Hey guys, I just saw that Death Stranding is coming to Game Pass PC."
With achievements.
With the Chivos. I thought it was a PlayStation exclusive. Also, why would it be on Game Pass PC and not the console version? Thanks. So, yeah, that was kind of head-scratching for me, too, because I wasn't sure exactly why one would and the other one wouldn't. But after finding an article on The Verge, it does kind of answer your question directly. So, from The Verge, it says, "Microsoft's official PC Game Pass Twitter account has been teasing the arrival of Death Stranding all week, and now it's official. Death Stranding arrives on PC Game Pass on August 23rd, spearheaded by Hideo Kojima, the developer best known for his work on the Metal Gear series. Death Stranding originally launched as a PS4 exclusive in 2019 before its PC release 2 years ago." Now, this is the part that answers your question. "Death Stranding's arrival on PC Game Pass is a boost to the service, but it doesn't mean the game is any closer to an Xbox release. Sony published Death Stranding on PlayStation in 2019, but 505 Games publishes the PC port. Sony still controls where Death Stranding lands on console, so it's unlikely we'll see it appear on the Xbox version of Game Pass." So when I read that, I was like, okay, that makes sense. 505 did the port. They can put it on PC wherever they want. If Microsoft wants to pay for that, maybe $600,000, I don't know, and they can put it on there, that's fine. But for Sony to just like not just roll up with the punches and just like put it on Game Pass, like, because you got to look at this too. Like, obviously they have this kind of big worry about like, oh, you know, are we still going to get our Call of Duty games? Are we still going to get Bethesda games? It's like, well, you're not playing ball either. Like, Death Stranding isn't even a company that you know, it's not even like Santa Monica Studios. This was Kojima Productions. It's not a
first-party studio.
Yeah, you're gatekeeping now Death Stranding, and it's like, you got to learn how to play the game, man, or you're going to fall behind. Like, you got to give one to get one. So, I'm not sure. It would be smart, in my opinion, for them to allow it to be on Game Pass maybe within a year, because the other thing is, like, it's been out since 2019. Everyone on the PS5 has played it. It's now on PS Plus if you haven't, and it's been on PC for 2 years. So all you're doing by not putting it out on Game Pass is losing money. You're leaving money on the table by not getting paid for it. So I don't know. As a third party game, I don't know why they wouldn't try to make money with that. How do you look at it?
I think my thought to it kind of was, because I feel like they're almost more like, oh well, we would be happier making a high amount of money than have it anywhere else. But when this game came out, reactions were pretty divided. I think they were expecting something more of like a Metal Gear caliber, this big over the top thing that everybody loves. There's a lot of people who didn't like this game. So that was kind of my first thought, not that it was terrible and I'm sure it sold well, but I'm like, I wonder if maybe it didn't reach the numbers they wanted it to. So like, okay, we can do it on Game Pass because that's not technically console, so that's not costing us console sales. We just won't put it on console. And then maybe if you do see it on console, maybe that's a sign that it didn't do that well at all to begin with. Who knows? Again, like I said, I know that game sold okay, but who knows what it cost to make and how much their deal was, that maybe they felt that this was the only way they could earn some of that back, and not just like, okay, well, the orange is squeezed dry over here. Let's try to get some more juice out of this thing. Let's put on Game Pass. Because I don't feel like that's their mindset just yet. But it could be. That could be a change in the tide, and this could be the first game. But again, I don't know. If you were going to do it with something, then maybe Days Gone would have been a better choice or something, especially since now they just announced they're doing a movie, because that game we know didn't do well compared to Death Stranding.
Yeah, sales-wise, but apparently everyone loves it. Like, it's supposed to be like a game that like everyone's like clamoring for this sequel, but like it doesn't seem to be happening, even though I think they sold, didn't they say they sold just as many copies as like Ghost of Tsushima or some weird, or some game like that, that was like why aren't you backing this up?
I feel like that
game, we're getting off topic.
Yeah, that one was more of the ones where like you, more people liked it than bought it, and Death Stranding seemed like more people bought it than liked it.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think it's very smart that 505 is at least taking what their rights they have and putting it to as many platforms as you can. Yeah, why not? That's how you make money. That's how a game's audience grows. You know, no one's, if you're on Xbox and you don't play, you're never going to know about it besides watching trailers and gameplay, like, online. But, like, the fact that it's now on PC, which is, you know, where a lot of people play, I think it's a good move. As far as it not being going to console, kind of sucks, but, I mean, what can you do, especially when Sony's kind of
playing? I don't know if I'd play it if it did come to console.
Well, it's so weird because I just started playing it on the PS5 the other day. And I got to the opening scene and then I'm like, oh, this does look pretty interesting. I don't know if I can get behind a walking simulator. But after watching the new trailer, like it has all like the director's cut, all the scenes I saw, and I'm like, oh, that looks pretty bad. This isn't the game I remember from 2 years ago when, you know, everyone was saying it should be game of the year. I'm like, that looked boring. The new trailer that I saw, I'm like, oh, this game actually looks pretty dope, so you know, maybe I will give it a try. But thank you for the question. The final question today comes from Kayla M, and she writes, did you guys read the rumors of the Darksiders 4 game? I really like this franchise and I hope it gets another sequel, maybe more at Gamescom, which is right around the corner. Do you guys like this series? So
I'll jump in first.
Sure,
because I actually don't like these games, so I could have cared less for any sort of news, so I'm gonna let Craig solely take this one away.
Okay, because I did want to ask you something in a second. So, so the rumors of Darksiders 4 has come out. So this comes to us from techforgamers.com, and it says, the game is allegedly titled Darksiders 4 Exodus. According to the leak, Darksiders 4 is a multiplayer looter brawler with four-player co-op. The title will allow players to use all the characters from the previous games, which sounds awesome to me. Furthermore, loot is divided into six categories, primary and secondary weapons, which are your melee and your range, upper armor, lower armor, your steed for horse customization, and relics. Excuse me. The playable characters are also divided into classes based on their playstyles. War is an all-rounder with his great sword and gauntlet. Death is the magic type with a great scythe and staff. Strife serves the role of a zoner with his daggers and dual pistols. And Fury utilizes her speed with the whip and crossblade weapons. The leak goes on to claim that all the characters play very different from each other. So, yeah, so that, the news to me sounds great, because if you do take the original Darksiders, which over the story is something that I like, because all the games are connected. So there's four games out right now, but it's Darksiders 1, 2, and 3, and then a prequel, which is Generations. So this would be the fourth one in the core titles of the games. But, like, the first one is like an action hack and slash kind of game, which, you know, comparable to like original like God of War. The second one's kind of more of a looter RPG. They dive in more of like those type of mechanics. The third one I think you actually might like the best, because I think it pays like an homage to like Dark Souls. It's kind of Souls like. So Matt might be the one that
I remember watching you play it.
Genesis was the first time they actually introduced multiplayer and did the top down version. But those, which is kind of cool. I like that all these games are kind of different styles. So It's not just like the same game being rinsed and repeated with different characters. There's something new to all of them. So now when you're adding this one in, that's going to be a full-on four-player looter game. I wonder, I ask you, as someone that didn't like or play any of the other ones, does a Borderlands-type appeal with what you're hearing, would that kind of capture your eye and maybe bring you into the series?
Actually, now that you said that, because I didn't even read the article, because I was like, oh, I could care less about
it. I know, that's what I was kind of picking up. Like, so he's not going to go fuck about, like, another
okay,
one.
Like, multiplayer, I could play it with Craig, that would be kind of fun, and then I'm in the mood for a looter that I'm like, okay, maybe this will be the one that I give, like, another chance. Because I tried the first one, I'm like, dude, this just ain't it.
Yeah, and that's fine. I know, because Darksiders, I mean, it made its sales. It did well, but it was definitely a write-off for a lot of people. Two kept it alive. Three was kind
what
of a
was it? War-mastered?
The War-mastered, and the other one was the Death Iterative Edition.
Yeah.
Three was kind of a step backwards for a lot of fans of the series. I actually really enjoyed Three. Three was, I thought, was a harder game compared to the other ones. It was cool seeing it from the female perspective.
Is that the one where he plays the girl?
Yeah, and so I loved it, and then I beat Genesis with Geno. So the fact that we're getting kind of like this multi, if the rumors are said to be true, a multiplayer game that's in the vein of like a Borderlanders, or even kind of looking kind of like we've been seeing games like Gotham Knights. I'm all for big four-party multiplayer games these days. And you throw in, you know, you flavor, you theme it with Darksiders. I'm actually super excited for it. Now, I think the article even says that the best thing, yeah, with GameComs being right around the corner, fans could be getting their first look at the game sooner than expected. So
I'll let you pay for it, and I'll just play it.
Yeah. Well, again, though, I like that they're moving the style of the game, if it is to be true, to something else. So you tell me, THQ Nordic made 5 games of the same series, and they all have something a little different to add.
It's because the first one wasn't that good.
The first one's awesome. I think play the War Master version. I think that's what you need, a nice updated
one. I won't play it based on that name alone.
Yeah, so Gamescom is coming up. I think that's going to run from the 23rd to the 28th. So obviously that'll be a good news week for us. We can kind of tackle that. Hopefully this is going to be there. So guys, that is the end of our episode. That brings an end to episode 144. Join us next time, guys, for episode 145. But until then, guys, my name is Craig Perales. This is Mandrew Montemayor. Cheers.
See you for 6 hours of GameCom. I haven't seen that. It was good.
You haven't seen the one From Russia with Love?
No.
Oh, dude, I'd watch that with you. If you want to watch Broken Arrow, and then we can watch From Russia with Love. Maybe we'll do a nice double feature.
I just watched something older the other day, and I can't remember what it was. Oh, I did watch
With John Travolta?
No, it was just something. I did watch Primal Fear for the first time.
Edward Norton?
Yeah.
And Richard Gere?
Yeah.
That movie's awesome.
Good for you. I forget. Marty.
Yeah, that's a good one. That's with a good twist. That, like, once yeah. you've seen it, it's like a... what's the Bruce Willis?
Sixth Sense.
It's like Sixth Sense. What you say is like, it's hard to go watch it again when you know it's coming with that big pop.
I feel like I watched something else. Fuck, what could I have possibly watched?
What do you do?
What's another, maybe it was like a Tom Cruise movie, possibly.
Just cruising down. Look at Andrew just giving it the T-bone.